welcome to Monday Mug Mentions. If you are traveling back from Gen Con, welcome back. And it sounds like me again. All right, we are going to have to figure out why that is happening. Thank you so much for helping me get that figured out, everyone. I appreciate it. Today we are drinking. Let's get into it. So we'll cut the first 3 minutes off of the recording, and we'll just start from here, right? Today we're drinking a delicious cup of Equal Exchanges Organic Mind, Body, and Soul. And it is so hot, you probably see the steam coming off of it right now. I'm so glad I sound like myself again. I really, really did not like that audio recording last week. It sounded terrible. And I fixed it on the replay, but it still had all this clipping and strange stuff. So I'm glad that it's working now. Alrighty. So Equal Exchange Organic Mind, Body, and Soul is pretty tasty. I got to be honest. I had a different Equal Exchange that Gil Mello sent me earlier in the segment. I want to say like week 4 or something like that. And it was better. I enjoyed the one you sent a little bit better. This one is a blend, and sometimes blends aren't exactly what I'm looking for, I guess. I like to try like a single bean a lot of times, and recently the ones I've been enjoying are the ones that are a single type of bean and not a blended, you know, group of beans. So this one is a blend. I think the one that Gil sent me was a really, really tasty, like Colombian bean. I really, really enjoyed it. So anyway, it is pretty good, but let's get into talking about the game stuff. I hope if you were at Gen Con, you had a blast. I hope you're rested. I hope you're well. I know that is a brutal convention in terms of the amount of time you spend there, the amount of games you play, whether you're demoing or you're just there attending. It can be a tough convention, I understand for sure. I'm going to fix one of my lights here too. Sorry about that. All right. Yeah, this is very hot coffee, but it's pretty tasty. Again, I like some of the others better. This is a blend that's supposed to be kind of chocolatey. And usually if it says chocolatey, it's not one of my favorite tastes in coffee. Like a little bit is okay, but I usually prefer like a more fruity tasting coffee. Gil says, still tired. I totally understand. It is, you know, you get drained from a convention by all means. I really appreciate you guys helping me out with getting the audio all set back on where it's supposed to be this week, too. So the game I want to talk about, or games I want to talk about this week, are games with, I guess you'd call them a push-your-luck mechanism. Now, there's an interesting thing here. Like, one of them is a straight-up push-your-luck game, probably the one you think of when you think of, like, an old-school 1980s push-your-luck game, what you would play. And I still enjoy playing this game. I actually have a video of myself playing it this afternoon just on Board Game Arena. So it is Can't Stop by Sid Saxon. And, I mean, this is the quintessential push-your-luck game, right? You're rolling dice, and we will get our fancy screen right over here, and we'll bring that up. And then we will throw a video up for you. So you can see, this is Can't Stop. This is on Board Game Arena. The, I guess you'd call it the, like, the interface is not the prettiest for Can't Stop. But I really, really enjoy playing this game enough that it doesn't really matter what it looks like, to be honest. I've seen a lot of different boards for it. The original board looks like a stop sign. If you look at my Facebook feed or Instagram feed, I've got a picture up of what the old school board looks like. Julie says rested is funny. Yeah, it takes about a week usually after convention for me before I'm feeling like super rested. I remember that. So I was sad to miss Gen Con this year, but I had work all weekend with my gig, so I could not do this convention and also focus on everything I needed to focus for my day gig. So anyway, I want to Derek says no rest, I'll sleep when I'm dead. Yeah, that's kind of how I generally operate, Derek. I totally understand, and I totally agree too. So Can't Stop, if you've never played, you're just rolling sets of dice, and then you kind of have the different pairs that make up numbers between 3 and 12 or 2 and 12, I believe. But you know, you'll notice that the middle numbers that roll more frequently have longer tracks to get to the end, and you're trying to claim tracks on these different lines that are going up per number. The thing is once you've put three of your markers onto a track, if you roll and you can't move one of those markers up, all the markers you've moved up for that particular turn just go away. You've lost everything. So it's a pure push-your-luck game. You're rolling and rolling and rolling and trying to take one of these deals. But, of course, if you roll, you know, if you choose 5, 7, and 11, And you're going to keep rolling dice. And if you can't pair up a 5, a 7, or an 11 when you roll these 6 dice, then you're done. You're completely finished. And it sounds pretty easy, like, oh, well, I should be able to do it. But you'll notice here, in my game, I'm sitting there rolling along thinking I'm going to be doing just fine. I get 2 of them. I think I was trying to push for the 3rd one, and I lost complete control of the board. I was lucky to pull off a win at the very end, but I had to just push my luck into the win. And that's part of the game as well, is you just continue to roll sometimes, you know, knowing that the game is coming up on an end. It's a very simple game. It's a fun family game. I think, honestly, you know, by the time my kiddo is 5, he'll be able to play this pretty easily. So it's an interesting game, and I really, really enjoy it, but it's got a mechanism that is incredible, which is just that feeling of being able to push your luck a little bit more, just a tiny bit further. You know, do I want to gamble on this next roll paying off and moving me up a track, or do I want to just stop and lock it in right now? Can't Stop is one of the few games that really gives me that game show vibe of, like, I'm, you know, do I want more? Do I want more? And then, like, do I stop now or do I want more? And it's kind of, you know, if you think about all the different game shows like that, of course, Press Your Luck, you know, no whammies, no whammies, stop. That's one of the games in my head that, like, resounds all the time. If you're not in your 30s, then you have probably no idea what Press Your Luck is or was. It was a game show that was amazing, and I wish the original version was still aired regularly somewhere. But it was essentially a game show board game with these little, you know, animated whammies that would come out and they would ruin your game and do stuff to your money or whatever it was that you were winning at the time and throw it in the trash or all sorts of things. It was incredible, but it's got that, you know, if you keep pushing for more, you have a better, bigger risk of hitting a whammy. You're also pressing this button to try and stop there, so it's got a little casino thing there, you know, and like Can't Stop's definitely got a casino feel because you're sitting there rolling dice and pushing for more and more and more. Craps is built on this very same mechanism. You know, you can keep rolling. If you don't know about the pass line, you can actually bet against the roller. You know, there's all sorts of things that you can do in Craps to continue trying to bet that the roll will continue or that the roll will stop. You know, if you can see that somebody's hot, you can bet on their roll if you feel like they're hot. Again, statistically, there is no proof that someone can ever be hot in Craps, but for whatever reason, people will get that feeling. And I think that's the same feeling in Can't Stop, where you're rolling and rolling and you're like, I'm hot, I'm gonna get this next one. You know, I got a feeling that this is coming. And that feeling for human beings is incredibly satisfying for whatever reason, of just trying to push for a little bit more, but potentially losing everything. I will say I was working on a little write and roll this weekend in some of my spare time with some of the stir fry dice. You'll even see them here. There's little pigs and soy sauces and noodles and stuff on the die, and you roll them. And I was trying to incorporate some of these mechanisms, and it really didn't play out very well. And I think one of the reasons for that is you've got to have a lot of agency over knowing when is the time to turn on or off, you know, your roll or stop or go. And with a 6-sided die, you know, it's common knowledge to know, you know, there's 6 sides on a die, so if we're rolling this many, my odds are relatively close to this. You know, you have a pretty good indication of what your odds are. With a bunch of different random icons, you really don't have any idea unless you play it out and you know exactly what you're looking for. So you've got to put, like, the frequency on the dice there, and there's some tricky stuff to that, I think, in terms of letting players just play. So, yeah, if anybody's ever designed a roll and write without using a number die, I would really like to talk to you about a few things that I'm experiencing in the design process that are really, really sort of like hurdles I don't understand how to overcome yet. So that's something we're working on right now, but, I've been looking into this more and things like Can't Stop and What's So Satisfying, trying to understand for our own game how we adapt certain, experiences, and create a fun experience. What I was playing yesterday just didn't seem fun in our first initial tests. So, let's move on from the video. You'll see here it just grows and grows. I think this game ended up taking a little while, even though it was a 2-player game. Sometimes it can take a while, but I think you'll see there I've claimed 2, and then I end up claiming a 3rd for a win. So that's a lot of fun. But I want to talk about another game that's a digital game called Speedrunners by Tiny Build. And this is another Press Your Luck game With a totally, I mean, it's definitely got a dexterity aspect to it. I think most dexterity games, even fighting games, when you think about it, have a press your luck aspect when you're talking about real opponents or even AI opponents. There's a certain moment where you're going to attack, hoping that they're not going to be blocking or whatever the case may be. In speedrunners, you're simply trying to run your opponents off the screen. And what I mean by that is you're trying to run a very difficult map from one location to the next. I think I'm catching up on comments. I know there's always a delay, but Courtney says no more whammies. I agree, no more whammies. That's I loved that show. It was so good. So in speedrunners, you're just running and trying to knock someone off the screen. You'll see that last person who was just on the screen there gets run past, and so they're dead, and they get to watch everybody else for the rest of the game, which is just a few moments. One gets locked out, someone else can run until they're off the screen, and that person is the winner of that round. You need to win three rounds total to win the race. So you start from where that person ended their run, and you can use a grappling hook, you can slide, and you're going through these little procedural deals, but the whole point is to run the other players off the screen. Now, the reason this is a heavy pressure luck game is you'll see there's these little trap doors, there's multiple different avenues to go through, right? In the split second, you have to make decisions, and I'm sure knowing the maps helps. I'm sure, you know, there's all kinds of information you can learn to inform your decision about what might be the better decision. But really, it's a snap decision you have to make where you're pressing your luck that the other person won't shut a trap door in your face, that you'll be able to be ahead of them coming out of one of the different tunnels, per se, that they won't have an ability behind to, you know, stop you. And you continue to try and do little things that are usually tricky, potentially things that will end your run, to try and get ahead of the next person. And there's a ton of pressure luck in that. I think almost any game where you're playing, and I'm going to stop and say hey to some folks. Hello, Michael Wright. I hope you had a good time at Gen Con. I think I saw some wonderful pictures of you there, sir. Welcome back home. I hope you're home. Or if you're traveling, I hope you're having a good travel. And Brad, hello. I hope you're either home or close to it. I know you said you were traveling earlier today, so I really hope that your travel is going well. Okay. So, again, you'll just see that this continues to be like a running and trying to get ahead of other people. And I played very poorly in this video that I shot. But the AI even plays well enough to give you an idea of what you should be doing, which is moving ahead at all times, not hitting things, not hitting obstacles. But at a certain point, you'll have to make a decision. There's two paths. If you're in the lead, which one do you shut off? Who is going to be the biggest, you know, possible threat? And there's a ton of pressure luck in a dexterity game like this. Any game where you've got those, you know, the runner games on your mobile devices, Temple Run is the quintessential one that people can just name, and that's sort of what they're, many of them I think are, you know, based on. But, you know, if Temple Run or any of those where you're running and swiping to the left and to the right, or jumping over things with your thumb and all that, that's a pressure luck game. You're on a straight track, and you're trying to continually navigate it. But usually they'll give you, you know, a few different avenues, and the most difficult ones will often have the best payout in terms of the gems you're picking up or whatever the case may be. So I really, really, really like that sort of, like, you know, personal challenge. I think that's what a lot of these games do, is give you a personal challenge while also giving you opponents. Of, did I make the right decision to press forward at that time and can't stop? It's, did I make the right decision to stop right there? Or is this player going to be able to roll up to the next number? And I really, really think that mechanism is pleasing to people. I think people tend to enjoy it. I think that there's an incredible amount of player psychology that you can tinker with once you get into the idea of people being the master of their own destiny. And, you know, if I roll this die one more time, I might be able to get that, but I also might end my, in my run, which would be terrible, and you don't want that to happen ever. So, I mean, that's, I love that. I love that sort of, you know, pressure luck thing. So, Michael, I'm glad to see you. Thank you for dropping by. Brad says, almost home, still in the car, just woke up and saw the time. Well, I'm sorry that I'm the first face you see when you wake up. That's unfortunate. So I hope you have a safe rest of your trip then, Brad, in that case. Speedrunners, again, if you haven't played it, it's a fun little co-op game by Tiny Build. Friends of mine at Tiny Build make awesome games. I would definitely say check it out if you have not. I really, really like the like fast-paced, verse each other. It's a great like couch game. If you have four controllers and you've got a, you know, setup that you can put your games on your TV from your PC or something like that. It's one of those games where you can like, you know, you just ran me off the screen. I mean, it's just the instant sort of like interaction that you can have with two people or four people sitting on a couch playing that game and run someone out is pretty incredible, and it's also really like pleasant. I enjoy it a lot. It's a great like it almost has that Mario Party feel where you get to like interact in real time with the players that are there. So I think Speedrunners is best played like in real person, but it's also a fun game to play online. Clinton, hello, good to see you, man. I hope you had a great Gen Con. I hope you're convention was fruitful. I don't know if you were just playing games, if you were pitching, if you were doing any sort of publisher meetings or anything like that, but I hope whatever you did, it was a good time. I really missed out. I had a blast watching everybody do their stuff. Speaking of which, this is a great time to talk about the media personality-esque that I'm talking about this week. This isn't a real long one. This is just, I don't know if any of you have ever been to any convention, but if you were at Gen Con or if you were on social media, you'll notice that Daniel Zayas does this amazing sort of meet and greet deal when he's meeting people, where he takes a selfie with the people at the booth or the publishers or some friends of his, and he does it with seemingly every single person he encounters at a convention, which I think is fun. I think it's awesome. And I think it's really like, if you've seen the photos, if you've seen his selfies, I call it the Zaya selfie or Zaya selfie. I've been mispronouncing Daniel's name for a long time. Zaya selfie. If you're in one, it's awesome. It feels cool to be like part of the club. And then if you're not and you get to see him, you see smiling faces at conventions. And it's like Daniel, of course, has this just he has a great smile. So he's smiling for the front of whatever it is. And then in the background, you've got whoever's at the convention. I mean, every single one of my friends, for the most part, this weekend, I was able to see an awesome photo of them smiling with Daniel. And it made me feel like I got to see their booths and see a little bit of their setup, see a little bit of what they had going on. And I really enjoyed that. I thought that was kind of a special thing. But Daniel's been doing this for a long time. So it's like, I don't know if you've ever been part of Isaiah's selfie. I've done a few of them, and they feel great. It's a great moment when Daniel comes by and takes a picture with everybody. So I don't know if you've ever done it before, but if you haven't, make sure you go up to Daniel and say, "What's up, man? Let's take the Isaiah selfie." And if you have done it, you've probably been tagged in the photo and you've done all sorts of things. My favorite one from this particular, or my favorite sort of thing about this particular Gen Con set is that Jason Mahone, from Big Kid Games, I believe, photobombed probably 90% of the Zaya selfies. So he's got his head just sticking out of different areas, and then you'll just see Jason Mahone with his big dome sticking out with sunglasses on or a big smile or something in a background of almost every single one of Daniel's selfies this particular convention. So it's like a fun moment within the fun thing that Daniel's already doing. I thought it was really, really good. Clinton says, "I pitched like a monster. I had four games I was presenting." There you go, man. I hope that they all went well. I hope you got to sign some stuff or at least got some good bites or nibbles. Brad says, "I got my selfie. It was great to meet him in person finally." I agree. It's always good to see Daniel in person. The first time I met Daniel in person, I think we did a big hug. We'd been working together for a moment at that point. So anyway, I just wanted to mention how nice it is to see smiling faces at a convention and see a positive outlook on everybody's booth, see a nice smile. And Jason says, "Yo, love my Zaya selfie with a massive photobomb to boot." I think, yeah, Jason Mahone got y'all's too, right? And I may be saying Jason's last name incorrectly. I try. There's so many folks in the industry that I'm trying to meet in person and learn their names over time, and it's very, very difficult, I will admit. There are a lot of people who work in board games. Yeah, if you haven't taken one of those selfies, make sure you go do it. Now, the last thing I want to talk about this week is simply word of mouth by like Gen Con Haul Photos. What this is this is like the digital version of word of mouth. Jason, good to see you, by the way. I'm glad to see you. I am still working on getting our panel uploaded to the internet. My phone is being less than friendly with my videos. So I've got to install some software to pull that video off my phone so that I can put it up on YouTube. But Jason and I did a panel at Kineticon on how to get your game signed with a publisher. And if I say so myself, I think it went very well. We had some good information that we shared, and by no means rules for how to get it done, but maybe some advice for ways to get it done. So good to see you, Jason. I hope that your Gen Con travel is over and you're home comfortably. So yeah, word of mouth and Gen Con Haul Photos. And what this is like, so word of mouth, I think previously you'd say that, you know, oh, okay, somebody just told me that, you know, Brad Taylor's upholstery company is the best, so I'm going to go get my chairs done there. Or I asked my friends for a recommendation on the best place, and they said Brad Taylor has the best upholstery shop in all of New York, and so that's where I'm going to take my stuff. So now we've got this digital age and social media, which has been around for most of the time, and you'll see people ask for recommendations and get recommendations from their friends on Facebook. This is the same thing, word of mouth marketing. What Gen Con Haul Photos do is they put a whole bunch of stuff together and give a big word of mouth marketing to a bunch of different publishers all at once. What happens is there's also a frequency of posting that's going to increase. Right after a Gen Con, you're going to see a bunch of pictures of people posting their haul. This is all the stuff I just bought, which is awesome. I mean, I honestly, after looking at a few Gen Con haul pictures, I could tell you I would have spent $1,000 on games at Gen Con. There were so many good games. I would have bought almost everything. It was a really, really incredible looking show. I'm kind of glad I didn't go, because I think we saved a ton of money by not being there. I would have gone crazy buying all my friends' games, and then I know a bunch of my friends' games sold out, and I would have felt bad buying those games when I know that, you know, I'll get a hold of them eventually. So I really, really think that the photos are an amazing thing when you see a bunch of different publishers' products all posted together. There's also, like I said, a frequency thing where you see it regularly, and you're going to see some of the same games cropping up, a lot of overlap in people's Gen Con haul photos because a lot of the same games were released. So you get this, I mean, this very, very organic grassroots marketing that deals with, you know, a large amount of people sharing with what is board game groups. I mean, it is absolutely just groups of board gamers that are sharing what they just got with other groups of board gamers. Now, somebody when I was discussing this before said that there is no cost to this for publishers. This is free marketing. I disagree greatly. There is definitely a cost involved, and that cost is absolutely the Gen Con, I mean, the booth that you just took out there, the product you had to print to take there, the staff you had to have to sell it, the, you know, hotel rooms and everything. Gen Con is not a cheap convention for a publisher, no matter what the size. And so that is part of, I think, the intention, is that people see these games in Gen Con haul photos. So it's not unintentional that they were at this convention. It's not unintentional that this sort of fallout is, or not, fallout's a bad word, this sort of follow-up posting is happening. It's part of the marketing. It's part of going to conventions. If you're a publisher, you need to be at conventions. You know, one of the only reasons we weren't there is we have very little product right now. We've had a great year. We've sold a lot of games. Unfortunately, that leaves us at a point where we're waiting on our restock and reprint to come in for even Stir Fry, and going to a show without product is expensive. So, you know, it's being at a convention like that with a release product, though, is absolutely big. You definitely want to go and show off your new big stuff. And any time that you buy a game at a convention, it tends to have a little more of a sentimental value sometimes. To me, at least, it does. I don't know. So Brad Taylor actually just spoke to this. He says, my haul isn't very large, but it's my first Gen Con haul. So special to me. And that's what I'm talking about. Like, it's pretty amazing that, you know, you get to go to a convention, have all these experiences, and then a game you maybe bought, or a couple games you bought from that convention, or hundreds of games you bought from that convention based on some people's haul photos, you know, are ones that are tied to that special, fun weekend in memory. And even as a publisher, like, if I pick up a game and get to play it at a convention, I usually remember it. Like, Path of Light and Shadow was one that I got at PAX South. And, I mean, I remember that show. I remember fun things that happened. I remember being told how awesome that game was by James Hudson, and then going, okay, well, I'm going to buy it right now then. And, you know, getting to hang out. I was right next to the Indie Boards and Cards booth. We were kind of back. We shared, a drape with Indie Boards and Cards. So I got to hang out with a lot of their staff, who are all awesome folks as well. And I remember that as a good weekend. So Path of Light and Shadows kind of like always got that going on for it when it's in my collection. Some other games, you know, like that I picked up from the actual publishers, like my Dice Throne Kickstarter, I'll never forget that. Like hanging out at PAX Unplugged and talking to Nate and Manny and getting to chat and all that. Even though we're all working, it's fun. So yeah, I agree. There's a sentimental value that doesn't always exist with everything else when you have convention, you know, purchases. So that's a very, very cool like side portion of it. And I really think that that's a cool thing that publishers get to do, is engage with their fans in real time and show off games and meet people. That's one of my favorite parts about being in the industry, to be honest, is that portion. One of my least favorite parts is the portion where I have to travel to another city and stay in a hotel room and all that stuff. I love staying in my own bed. So I have to go outside my comfort zone for sure to go and do a convention in different cities. But I enjoy meeting people so much and getting to do the convention portion that it's totally worth it. So, yeah, I think that's pretty much about all I've got for this week. Unless you guys have got any questions, I will take another sip of coffee and catch up on comments here. Yeah, Brad says, true fact, I think he was talking about the Gen Con Haul and how those pictures work. And Jason, I'm glad that you got to have your Zaya selfie there, too. So, all right, y'all. Well, I really appreciate you hanging out this week. I am going to get back to work. I've got nothing but work to do, and I have got a bunch of phone calls to make to see why some of our projects are held up. And then I get to do a lot of other fun work on other fun things that we've got in the works right now that I still can't talk about. I really, really can't wait to tell you guys about our next big one. But we've got Bloom in the works. We've got Cookie Bandit, tentatively named, a social deduction game about who stole the cookie from the cookie jar, in the works. And I met with the designer of that last week. Did have some excitement last week. Got into a little fender bender after dinner and got a parking ticket in Boston. So that was fun as well. But other than that, everyone's okay. No one was hurt, and that's what's important. Other than me having to most likely pay my deductible for my insurance and deal with all that fun stuff. So, but no one was hurt, and that's what's super important. And we got to have a great meeting about what some of our ideas are for that game. So I appreciate y'all hanging out this week. I hope you are having a wonderful week. Have some coffee. If you're a game designer, design some games. If you're just a game player, play some games. And we'll see you next week, same time, same place. Thanks again. Bye-bye.